Okay, I think we are live. A very warm welcome to everyone. Thank you all for joining us today evening. We'll wait for a minute or two to let people to join in. Hello everyone, my name is Devansh, and with me I have Hitesh. I am the lead for Developer Students Club, Bharatiya Vidyapeeth Deemed University College of Engineering, Pune. Hitesh, you can go on to introduce yourself.
Yeah, sure. So, hi all. Myself Hitesh Tomar, and I am currently the DSC lead for Engineering College of Bikaner. And a bit about our club. What you can say is, we are initiating. We are actually more focused on peer-to-peer learning. So, talking about the initiatives. Like I and Devansh are planning to have 30 days of ML code, and also we are. Currently, we are working on majorly focusing on building some projects, like for helping out some communities, local businesses. So, yeah, a bit about our club. So, this is all, and yeah.
Yeah, so Developer Student Clubs is a Google Developers Initiative, and under that initiative, we have now we are also we are taking initiatives for students to learn new programs, different frameworks, different Google technologies in the domains of web development to mobile app development to machine learning to cloud development. And there are a lot of people. We try to introduce inculcate our culture of learning and growing together and building stuff together. So that's what a Developer Student Clubs is about. And yeah, we are also planning, we are currently organizing a 30 days of Android Study Jams program. We are currently having a hackathon DSE WoW. So these are a few initiatives that we are thinking we are having right now. And we have a lot of stuff planned for the future. So stay tuned and keep taking part in such events excitedly. So I am more than, we'll just wait for a minute and then we'll introduce our speaker for today. Right, so yeah, I think. Yeah, you can go on to introduce yourself. You can show your introduction slide that. You could introduce yourself to the audience.
Yeah, so should I start?
Yeah.
Yeah, so thank you to the Developer Student Club of ECB BTU and VVPCOE. So definitely it's a pleasure for me to conclude my year with such an awesome talk at such awesome Developer Student Clubs, which are really focusing towards learning and towards making peer-to-peer learning more awesome. So that's why as the organizers were discussing about some 30 days of ML and stuff like that related to machine learning, related to data science, stuff like that. So I thought that how about creating a roadmap, or how about sharing with you a roadmap which you can focus upon to start your journey of data science as well as machine learning. So further ado, so hi, I am Ayon Roy, a final year student of Bachelor's of Technology in Computer Science Engineering from New Delhi, India. And I'm currently a data science intern at Lulu International Exchange. So that's a financial service company headquartered in Abu Dhabi. So I have certain experiences, or the mistakes that I did, or what were one or more of my learnings towards these data science and machine learning journey. So I would try to inculcate those things into this session so that you do not repeat those mistakes, or you do not go around the same thing again and again and without getting something out of that, right? So I can just figure it out, like how things work and how you can also focus on that at that point of time, so that you do not waste your time, and so that you get to the original stuff at the very first. And I also had the privilege of bringing Kaggle Days meetup community for the first time in India. So that's where we discuss about data science, machine learning, AI, Kaggle. So like a lot of stuff around these domains. So related to Developer Students Club only. So we are trying to make peer-to-peer learning stuffs in data science and machine learning more friendly and more accessible. Like I have divided today's session into certain parts, like because it makes more sense for you to understand what the flow of the session would be, so that you can keep yourself motivated, so that you can also frame your questions. In case if you have any questions, do let me know in the chat, in the live chat, and I will be happy to answer them once I end my session, right? So I will just go through the questions at the end of the session and I can answer them as we go. So like, this is how I have planned my session. So before diving into starting with a roadmap in data science or machine learning, so what's the current scenario? It's really important to understand what's the current scenario. That would really increase your attention towards these domains, like why actually you need to learn these things or why there is a hype around that. So it's really important to understand those things. So that's why I focused on the scenario, the current scenario in the market. Then what is data science and what is machine learning? Because we are focusing on roadmap to data science and machine learning. Then how to start machine learning, because after we would be defining what data science is, what machine learning is, you would come to a conclusion that definitely these things are somewhat similar, or these supplement each other. So then once you understand that, we would be at a better position to help you with how to start machine learning. Here, what things you should learn, what things, which courses you can opt for, or what are the course functionalities or core things you should look forward to understand things better before you are starting machine learning or data science. Then once you understand that, from here you will get a flavor about like how you play with hell lot of data, right? While I'm briefing you about how to start machine learning, you will get a hell lot of idea about data, like a hell lot of data. So like then it would be like, then we would be at a better position to discuss what are the major steps in a data science process, and we can map it to machine learning also, like machine learning algorithms and stuff like that. We can just map it, and then you can get a complete overview about what stuffs are and how things work. And then once we discuss the major steps, what are the major steps in data science process, we can go ahead with a few steps in data science, like major few steps in data science processes, that is data pre-processing, exploratory data analysis, data visualization. So these are a few core functionalities while you are doing a data science project or data science internship. And apart from that, once we cover all these things, then we would focus on how to start, or like what projects you can start with, because now you understand which things you should focus on or what stuffs you should focus on. Now we are at a better position to understand what projects to start and what are the type of data sets you as a beginner, or if you are an intermediate, what things you can focus on. So this would be our flow of the session, and I hope that the session would be useful for you. And I would definitely love to answer your questions at the end of the session. So what's the current scenario? Like, though we do not need to discuss in depth, because every time you open your LinkedIn, every time you open your any Reddit or Facebook or stuff like that, you see either application of AI, machine learning, data science, or either you read about those stuff, like what are the new advancements. But why is this happening? Or why is world crazy about this data science and machine learning stuff? You can though this graph is not of recent days, it's around 2015 or 2016 kind of this graph was fetched out in 2015 or 16, which suggested that 90% of the world's data was created in last 2 years. Like, it's highly prevalent in India. Like, in case we consider the case of India, like from 2015 or 2016, the boom of geo networks, right? Geo 4G came into picture in India, and every now and then people started shifting to 4G phones, and they have better connectivity to internet. They started buying feature phones, right? So they also started generating data. The more smartphones, the more devices you have, the more data you generate. So 2015-16, from a point of view of India's ecosystem, definitely things have been changing. And from a world's perspective, it was like 90% of the world's data was created in the last 2 years. So you can understand that last 2 years, like let's say around 2013 to 15, while this graph was being compiled, you can understand that 90% of the data was created then. But after 2015, like that's marked here today, right? After that, you can see the exponential growth. Like in 2020, it was expected that AI deep learning would definitely be playing a major role, and it's definitely playing a major role, right? Every time you see algorithm or any application, it's definitely a core machine learning, deep learning, AI related stuffs. So that's why it's the scenario, and we should focus on, like, because you can see the exponential growth, and why not as a student explore this and try to enter industry where we can also contribute towards the society's society's attraction or society's step towards making it more better and better place to live in with the help of AI and deep learning or machine learning data science, as you say. But this was from a graph, like how things have been from a data, from the data generation point of view. But let's say from supply and demand, like supply and demand from the talent, like what is the talent supply? Like we want 1 lakh data scientists. So this is our demand, but what's the supply? So why industry is crazy, and you see that every other organization or every coaching institute out there who is training you in data science, Python, they have been increasing exponentially. Like every other institute is now offering data science or machine learning as a course. But why? If you see this graph, like if you see this on the x-axis, that's the market demand. So when you see towards the right, it's high, right? It's written high. Why? Because like when you see that high, and on top of that, you see a yellow bubble. On yellow bubble, you can see that machine learning and data science. That's the market demand. Like market demand is fostered by industries, fostered by certain communities, fostered by certain projects. So that market demand of AI, machine learning, and data science projects are really high, as you can see. And the talent supply is one of the lowest, right, as of now. Because I'm not speaking that there are not enough data scientists, there are not enough machine learning engineers. But when we are talking about this talent supply, it's the actual thing that industry requires, that they should understand the basics. It's not that machine learning enthusiasts or data science enthusiasts are counted in this. It's not the case, because machine learning and data science, when it comes to industry from the point of view, it definitely takes efforts, and it definitely takes a good sound knowledge about mathematics and other statistical knowledge. So keeping in mind that talent supply, that how much the students that are graduating have a good knowledge about the maths required for data science or machine learning, it's comparatively low, and you can see the demand that high. Why not capture this, right? Why not be around that yellow bubble, machine learning and data science? So that's why students like me are trying to explore if we can make ourselves count in that talent supply for data science and machine learning, because we see a huge opportunity there, right? So this was good enough for you to get attracted towards this domain if you are not, right? But I hope that you are already interested in this domain. That's why you joined this session, and you are also trying to focus, or you are trying to explore these domains. So like you are in the safe hands, and definitely your choice for data science and machine learning is one of the best choice you would have made as a student, keeping in mind it's 2020 and the years to come. So like now as we explored the current trends, current scenarios in the industry, now we are at a better position to understand, because we have been discussing a hell lot of machine learning, data science related stuffs in the last 5 to 6 minutes, right? So it is now required for you to understand what data science is, so that the further flow of this session is into a good hands, and we can just move it through very easily, right? So that you also understand the stuffs, and it's easier for me to explain those stuffs to you. So what is data science? Like not going to this definition at the first go, from a word only, like what is data science? So it's like science related to data, right? You science, when we talk about science, it's physics, chemistry, maths, stuffs like that. So science related to data, like we have data and we are making surgery on data. Like if we talk about that, so it's like a hell lot of data. Let's say data is a body, and we are a biology student, like in science student, and we are operating on that data, or we are doing a surgery on that data to bring something out, or to make our lives more easier, right? So that's from a world's perspective. But when it comes to industry, how industry defines it, so it's like a complex study. Like a complex study, why I'm speaking it's complex, because here you have to understand the stats, you have to understand where the data comes from, how the data comes from, database connectivity, where my data is getting stored, or like how is my computation going to happen, right? So a hell lot of things that goes into this studying, like into studying of this data, and so that you can also do data science on top of that. So it's a complex study of large amounts of data. where you try to focus on where my data is stored and how is my data stored, or like how I can use that data for future growth of my organization, right? Whether you are intern at an organization, whether you are a data scientist at an organization, you're trying to utilize that data to bring something out of it. And then data scientists are like, when we talk about data science, who do these data science related stuffs, they are called data scientists, right? But in which stuffs they are more skilled enough, right? So it's more into algorithmic coding. So not that stack queues and like competitive coding. I'm not speaking that you have to be 5-star on CodeChef or stuff like that. You just need to have a sound knowledge about Python and like related stuffs, and a good knowledge about the algorithms that are being used in data science, machine learning. So we will focus which type of things you should focus on to explain these things. On top of that, like a person who is a data scientist has a good knowledge of data mining, machine learning, and statistics. So that's why I told you that machine learning and data science are somewhat interrelated, and that's why we focused on how to start machine learning, not how to start data science, because these terms can be used intermittently, right? So like a data scientist ought to have good knowledge about data mining. When we talk about data mining, it's like database, like how is my data stored, how I can use that data, and machine learning definitely, and statistics. So when we talk about complex study, you have to use those, like I'm not speaking that you need to learn all those mathematical concepts, but definitely a sound knowledge of mathematics when it comes to probability. Like we will discuss how to start machine learning. We will discuss what parts in maths you should cover. Now we discussed what is data science and what a data scientist is ought to know, or what he or she should know in order to produce results for the industry. And we also discussed that data scientists should have a good knowledge about algorithmic coding when we talk about that normal coding for building stuffs, and then data mining and machine learning. Then you now are curious about what machine learning is. So here comes, like, what is machine learning? Like from the word itself, we are not again going directly into the industry definition. It's like a machine which is learning, right? When we talk about machine learning, it's like you as a student or you as a child also learned something. Your mother or your family told you that, hey, see, this is an apple that's red in color, and it looks like this in the shape, right? So you also learned as a child. It was not that you were born and you already knew that this is apple. You were taught, you were made to learn these things. So it was like for you, it was a human learning. But same stuff happens with machine learning too, right? You tell your machines, see that I am giving you 1,000 images of cat or 1,000 images of apples, and this is how these things look like. And now learn this, like how things work or what are the patterns. And next time when I send you these images, like whenever I send you an apple's image, whenever I send you a cat's image, you should be able to predict. So that's what our machine learning is trying to obtain. It's like we are trying to make our machines more intelligent, right? Like so that we just put an image to the machine and it's able to give the output as we want, like a human. Like if a human sees an apple, he or she will definitely tell it's apple. But we are trying to mimic that kind of intelligence in a machine through artificial intelligence. Like we are making our machines more intelligent through that. But machine learning is just a path towards that. Like we are using machine learning to make our machines intelligent, because machines are not human. So we call them artificial, right? So we are trying to improve the intelligence of artificial things. So that's artificial intelligence. Why we are telling that it's not a field, machine learning is a field of study where you do not explicitly program. That's why we are talking about this is, like, let's say you were told that this is how an apple looks like. Every time, once you learn that, every time after that, you were not told that, hey, see this. It was not that you were explicitly told. You were able to take your decisions on your own. So machines also take their own decisions without being explicitly programmed after training them, right? In the initial days, you were also trained. Machines also has to be trained at the first go. And then the inputs, like how the machine learns, it's through data, right? Be it image, be it text, be it any stuff. So machine also needs data to learn, to understand. So this was what is data science, what is machine learning. And now when we go, like, now you will be focusing on what's the difference between data science and machine learning, because I told you that these terms are related to each other, and like a data scientist ought to have a good knowledge about machine learning algorithms or data mining, statistics. But I was also curious, what's the difference between data science and machine learning? So I just went to one of our favorite websites as a student, that's Geeks for Geeks, right? I just went to that website and tried to get a screenshot of that. So according to them, if you see machine learning, combination of machine and data science. So because it's interrelated, right? So machine learning also uses data, and here you also have to use certain algorithms, certain statistics to get something out of it. But on top of that, it's like you use data to make your machines more intelligent, and through that data, you make your machines learn that, hey, look, this is how things look like. But data science majorly focuses on preparing the data and like cleaning the data and stuff like that, because once you get a data in the format which machines can understand, you can give that data to the machines and can tell them that, hey, see, this is how things look, and you try to learn. But it's not that data scientist, if you want to become a data scientist, the route is completely different, or if you want to become a machine learning engineer, the route is completely different. It's like how to start machine learning, or even if you get started with data science itself, or like these terms are used interchangeably most of the times, but it's like a small definition. It's like data science is like we always talk about the science related to data, and once we apply all our sciences on that data and get the data in a format which machines can act upon, we try to provide that data to our machines, and the machines try to learn. So that's machine learning and data science relation. So that being said, now you understand what's the current scenario, that how industry is progressing, what's the supply, what's the demand. And then now you also understand what data science is, what machine learning is, like how they're used interchangeably, right? And on top of that, what's the minute difference that might be there? Like I was also curious to know about that. So I also went to Google, but most of the time it was like, just start, right? It was like, whenever I read those blogs between difference of data science and machine learning, it was like, whichever you start at the end, 90% or 80% of these things are completely same. So as a student, if you're just starting, do not be in the dilemma that I only want to become a data scientist, I only want to become a machine learning engineer. Any path you choose, definitely you are moving towards that common 80% at the initial go, right? So like I have tried to keep that session in that way, so that at least you get something out of it and you can also utilize them at a later point of time. So how to start machine learning, right? Like we discussed, what is machine learning, what is data science and stuff like that. But now comes the roadmap, right? How a person, or how as a student, can explore, or how a student can start machine learning. What are the things he or she should look upon at the first go? Start with maths for machine learning. Why I'm talking about this is, initially I didn't approach machine learning from the maths part initially, right? Because I thought that it's all about coding, it's all about Python, it's all about R. I started directly with that, but I was also going well. But when I started doing certain complex projects, it was like my mathematical basics were not that strong at that point of time. And I again have to come back to maths and then have to start from scratch. So that's why every time I now suggest anyone, or I mentor someone to start machine learning or to start data science, I always talk to them with this thing in mind, that always have the mathematics part in your mind at the first go. Why you should start with maths is because you are just passed out of school. Maybe you are in first year, second year, third year. You have studied maths in first year or second year, and definitely you have studied those things in class 12 too, right? So you already have a mathematical competence in your mind now. So it would be definitely easier for you to grab those things like maths for machine learning. But now you know that maths is huge. Like I am not speaking that read those thick R.D. Sharma's as of now, right? But for machine learning, the complete mathematics is not required. But there are certain things in mathematics that have to be kept in mind while starting your journey for machine learning. So like, I know that multiple of you might have this feeling in mind that, oh my God, this person has gone mad, that he's starting the session for like roadmap to data science and machine learning with this mathematics thing in the first place, right? But like my journey has always made me learn that mathematical basics are definitely useful. You can, if you have a strong basic, definitely you can fetch things up and you can make something awesome. So why should I do maths first for machine learning? One of the biggest question is that one advantage is now you are fresh, your mind is fresh towards learning maths, and you already have a competency towards maths. And next part is like from my personal experience, like without maths, you can start. I'm not speaking that without maths, you cannot start. But after, let's say, 2 to 3 months, after you're done with the basics of machine learning and you're trying to explore the certain typical stuffs of machine learning, then it becomes a little bit trickier. And you have to read research papers, you have to read certain state-of-the-art algorithms. And there you find a little bit difficulty, like how things go, or how should I move ahead to these things. So that these are the two things that why you should start maths first for machine learning. But what things in mathematics you should keep in mind for starting machine learning? So a few things, only 4 things in maths that are required. So linear algebra, first of all, linear algebra is required. If you do not know what linear algebra is, it's around matrix determinants and stuff like that. So these are really helpful because when you get your data, you have to put those in data frames and stuff like that. So linear algebra definitely plays a major role. And calculus is for differentiation. Like every time you might have heard about gradient descent and stuff like that in machine learning. So these are slope of a line, or you have heard about linear regression. You make a line in linear regression, right? So in line, you know that line's formula is y is equal to mx plus c. So what is m? It's a slope. And you might have read in class 12 that m in class 12 or class 11 that m, the slope is dy by dx, right? So that's a differential calculus. Then you have accuracy, area under curve. So you can read about those things. Once you start your journey of machine learning, you will come across those terms. And then you will realize that, oh my God, if I had a good knowledge about those, at least a sound knowledge of these terminologies, it would be definitely easier for me. So linear algebra, calculus, probability. So why probability? Machine learning is all about probability, right? You can only predict that, yes, if I recommend this stuff, the person would buy or stuff like that. And statistics, mean, mode, median, and stuff like that are definitely useful when you're playing with data. So when I'm talking about starting with maths for machine learning, I'm focusing on linear algebra, calculus, probability, statistics, right? So don't worry, I will be sharing a link with you folks where you can just go through all these course links that you're seeing on the screen, and you can access them at a later point of time too. Now, as you now understand that what mathematical concepts are required, and your next step would be to implement those stuffs, right? Because now you understand what mean, mode, median, matrix determinants are and how these things work, and you would try to implement those things. Now we are at a better position to start implementing those things using Python, because what happens is if we only start Python, it's like we are going round and round. Like we go to OOPS, we then go to file handling, we go to the competitive programming and stuff like that. We only understand that Python is only about coding and not implementing stuffs which really adds value to real life, right? So now you have a thing in mind that, yes, I will utilize my Python knowledge to implement those mathematical concepts. That way you will be at a better position to understand things, to implement things, and doing things that really matters from the first go. So maths, start with maths and try to implement those mathematical concepts that you learned using Python. Like maybe a lot of you thinking I am cheating on you, but definitely these steps that I'm speaking about are all through my learning experiences, that how I learned and what were my mistakes. I try to rectify them and have been talking about this to all my fellow mates and juniors, seniors, or stuff like that who asks me about how to prepare. Then once you understand the maths, once you understand how to implement those mathematical concepts using Python, now you have a good knowledge about Python. You have a good knowledge about the mathematical concepts. Now it's better that you start exploring the libraries. That when we are talking about libraries, it's like the machine learning libraries or the data science libraries that you might have heard. You might be familiar with this. You might have at least heard of the names of NumPy, Pandas, Scikit-learn, or like Matplotlib. So different libraries are there, which helps you to do those machine learning as well as data science related stuffs. But now you are definitely at a better position to enroll in a course and to understand what those folks are really talking about. Like what those folks, like let's say if you enroll in a machine learning course, but then you are in a dilemma that, oh, I do not know Python, I do not know the mathematical basics, then though enrolling in that Python course or enrolling in that machine learning course won't be of that much use. So now now I'm focusing on, you can now enroll in certain machine learning courses because you have a good knowledge about Python, you have a good knowledge about maths, and you also know how you can implement those mathematical concepts using Python. So, but which courses to do? Like now I told you that, hey, go and do certain machine learning courses. But a few things that doesn't require any link to be provided, it's like there is a course on Coursera, that's by Andrew Ng, Introduction to Machine Learning, that's in collaboration with Stanford University, I think. You can go and search and definitely do that course. Though I know it's in the assignments that you have to submit is in Octave, but definitely it's not that you can learn. I'm not speaking that learn Octave like separately or stuff like that. You can just do a day study of Octave and you will be very much fluent to implement those things in your assignments. But the learnings that you get in that course by Andrew Ng on Coursera, that's definitely good. And that can definitely set a very good value for you to start your journey of machine learning, where he would be talking a hell lot of mathematical concepts, and that would definitely help you. Apart from that, there are certain courses on DataCamp. So DataCamp, there is a machine learning, introduction to machine learning course kind of stuff. And on top of that, you have this introduction to Python for data science. Maybe like you directly want to jump to courses, like you just want a course which will help you to learn Python only for data science related stuff. So there is a course on DataCamp, you can focus on that. And then want to dive into data visualization or data processing, pre-processing, we will focus on that at a later point of time in this session only. And then deep learning, definitely you can go to deeplearning.ai. You have a hell lot of stuffs out there. Then you can focus on NLP, computer vision, as your interest grows. But at the first go, it's definitely important that you go to that Andrew Ng course and understand the basics. Once you understand that, it would be very much easier for you to understand things better, and it would be very much easier for you to do stuffs. But once you start your journey, you are now in a dilemma that how machine learning codes look like, or how actually folks do machine learning, or how actually folks write machine learning codes. That's really important question in the mind of a student, right? How actually a code looks like, which I'm trying to build. So how ML codes are written and how it works and how it looks like, I have provided a link, and you can definitely go and check it there, that how industry-ready machine learning codes are written. So don't worry, once I end the session, I will just give you a compact link where you can find all the links to the courses that I'm discussing, or all the links that you're seeing in the screen. So now you understand what are the major steps in machine learning, like what are the major steps that you have to focus on to start your journey with machine learning, maths, Python for machine learning or related stuffs. And then once you understand those things, you can try to enroll yourself in a course for machine learning and stuff like that. But whenever you enroll in a machine learning course, or whenever you enroll in this data science related course, they would always start from a few basic steps. Like few basic steps, when we talk about few basic steps, what are those? So we would focus on those things, like what are those steps in a go. So what are the major steps in a data science process? Because now you understand what things you should learn to kickstart your journey of data science, machine learning, and which courses to do, or what steps, what things in mathematics you need to understand, or stuff like that. You already know these stuffs, but whenever you start a course, they always focus on certain specific pointers. Like you might have heard about certain data pre-processing. You have to do that, you have to do this. But what actually they're talking about? Like what is that they are majorly focusing upon? So I have tried to focus on how a real world data science process looks like, because it's really important that after you enroll in a course, or after you are into this domain of data science or machine learning, it's really important to understand how actually a real world data science process looks like, or how actually a machine learning real world process looks like. So this is how a simple process of data science or machine learning would look like. So first of all, in reality, you see an Earth, right? In Earth, you and me are the consumers. We have laptops, we have smartphones. We are using those devices to surf net, to chat on WhatsApp, to view the videos on YouTube, stuff like that. So every time you do those stuffs, the companies are getting the data. at what time of the day is Ion logging in at LinkedIn, or at what time of the day Ion is usually opening YouTube for videos, or at what time is Ion opening Netflix to binge watch, right? So every time you do those stuffs in a real world, all these data points are collected. Let's say in this case, we would be focusing on, focusing on the YouTube recommendations, let's say, okay? So I opened YouTube 3 or 4 times a day, right? Let's say. And every time I open, the raw data is collected. When I talk about raw data, it's like from where is Ion accessing, be it Delhi, be it Bangalore, be it West Bengal, be it Bikaner, in any place, right? So raw data is collected from the location point of view. Which device am I using? Like it's an Android phone, or it's an iPhone, or it's a laptop with Ubuntu OS, or like all those stuff, it gets logged. And what type of things is Ion watching? Is it like always data science related stuff, or he is watching, let's say, Ashish Chanchalani vines, right? So what he is watching, or what he is more interested into? Is he interested into dogs? Is interested into cats? So everything you serve, every video you watch, these data forms raw data, right? So every time you do any stuff, the raw data gets collected and it goes to the server of YouTube, right? So once the data is there in YouTube's server, there are a hell lot of crap, hell lot of null values might be there, right? So maybe I just opened the video, but I never played it. So YouTube would check whether I really played that video or was it an accidental click. So we need a hell lot of data data processing, whether this video was actually watched by Ion or he just clicked and came back. So they want a hell lot of data processing. But how would they do a data processing through a machine if the data is too much of a garbage, right? Because if my data is too much like not of use, or it's not in a structure, how would YouTube know, or how would the YouTube recommend me stuff? So they want a clean data. So when we talk about clean data, let's say sometimes there is a missing data that my net got disconnected and there was no data point being noted, like there was no transmission of the data to the server sometimes. So like there are a lot of things going on. So they want a clean data set which really looks good and which is really in the format on which machines can understand, on which machines can do their processing. So once they do the pre-processing, what is pre-processing? We will definitely focus on in the next steps, in the next slides, and how it is done. We will also discuss that so that you can just go home with this after this session. Like you are definitely at home, but definitely you after watching this session, you can just take notes, or you can just kickstart your journey towards data pre-processing or towards data science processes. So data is processed. And now you get a clean data set. Like let's say the YouTube data science team now gets a clean data set. They would do an exploratory data analysis. Like they would make, when we are talking exploratory data analysis, it's like they're exploration. They are exploring my data. Like what they're exploring, how much time does Ion use YouTube in a day? Or if he's using YouTube for 2 hours a day, what he's watching? Is he watching only the videos of his exam preparations? Or he is also watching videos of, let's say, FIFA or any live game streaming, right? What he's watching. So they want to explore that, explore all my data that I have just gave them. So like on which day of the week is Ion utilizing YouTube the most? So they can already make a visualization that on Sunday, Ion utilizes YouTube most. Or these are certain exploration that YouTube can do. So once they get this clean data, one thing is that they can do exploratory data analysis, exploration of the data that they have regarding Ion as a user. Similarly, different users have their different profiles. So they do the profiling. Let's say sometimes you also see that this is number one trending on YouTube. How do they combine that? It's like exploration, that how much this data, how much this video is being watched, or how many users are watching this. So that's an exploration in a combined basis, like keeping in mind India is a country. So from the entire India, they just combine all stuff and see which is the video that's being watched most of the times, or is being watched comparatively more. So they did that exploratory data analysis and they just make it number one on trending, or number two on trending. On top of that, that was only analysis, exploratory data analysis. But now you also get those pointers, like how much time you utilized on the YouTube and stuff like that, and on a Google Wellbeing app, right? So now Google Wellbeing is an app Digital Wellbeing is an app where you can see how much time you spent on your app or in your mobile. So all those stuffs you can do. But how about the recommendation? Like number one trending on YouTube is definitely good. But how about recommendations? So YouTube also utilizes data science or machine learning to recommend you. So on the top of clean data set, it will see that, oh, Ion watches this kind of videos, like let's say cat videos or dog videos on, let's say, Sundays, or he wants to watch stand-up comedy on certain days. So they will train a model. So here comes the part of a machine learning, right? Here they are feeding the data into a machine and they are running certain algorithms, be it linear regression. There are certain algorithms out there. They are running those algorithms, they are running those models and making decisions, like they are giving the decision as, let's say, recommend these dog videos to Ion. Whenever he opens YouTube, just the top 2-3 videos should be of dogs, or top 2-3 videos should be of cats. So you are taking the decisions. The machine learning model is helping you take decisions on the basis of data that you just sent to the YouTube server, like they are collecting the data, right? So on top of that, they are making data products. They are making YouTube more and more friendlier. They are leveling up the game for YouTube recommendations. So those are how data products are built. And this is how a real world organization utilizes data science, right? They make decisions, they do certain analysis, they communicate the results, and then they give back the data product again to the real world. So it started from real world, that you as a consumer gave the data, the raw data was collected, and it went through data science, machine learning, several other steps of data science, data pre-processing, and other hell lot of other stuff. And then once it was run through them, the YouTube team did exploratory data analysis, they did machine learning models on top of that. They recommended you, and they give back, that recommendation again to you, so that you can get glued to that screen and you can watch more and more, right? So that the advertising policies of YouTube gets profitable and they generate more revenue. So that's how a data science process or how a machine learning model algorithm is being used in a real world ecosystem. But here you see in this data, in this flow, you can see that data is processed. So before data set, clean data set, there is a thing written that's data is processed. So that is actually called data pre-processing. And then you can see a box called exploratory data analysis. So exploratory data analysis, we will discuss. So we will discuss a few things, data pre-processing in the next slides, exploratory data analysis and data visualization. How, like at the bottom, you can see communicate, visualize, report, right? So here data visualization comes, and exploratory data analysis and data pre-processing. So these three things, or these three major steps of a data science process, we would discuss in the next few slides. So what is data pre-processing? As the name suggests, before, like if you see in this diagram, before giving the data to a machine or if before giving the data to models, you want to process it. Like, is my data missing, or how can a machine understand that, right? Because you cannot throw anything to the machine, because it's like if you throw garbage in, it will give the garbage out only, right? So you want to figure it out, like how should I pre-process my data, or pre-process means how should I tune the data, or how should I play, or how should I make the data in such a format that machines can understand and can take decisions on top of that. So that's the single motive behind doing this data pre-processing. And it's a technique, just a technique, which definitely, even if you are starting with machine learning or even if you're starting with data science, definitely the first step is data pre-processing. Once you get the data, you just pre-process the data, like to make it more cleaner, to make it in a more understandable format so that machines can understand and machines can take decisions on top of that. But why do we actually need it? So like, we understand that, yes, okay, we got our data from real world, and then we need to pre-process it to make it more clean, to make it in an understandable format. But why actually we need it? Cannot we directly get the data in an understandable format from the real world? Then if we would got the data in an understandable format at the first go, we would not have to do this data pre-processing and stuff like that. So we start with raw data that we talked about, that's real world data, and it's always messy. When we talk about messy, it's like either the data set is broken, or like sometimes the pointers or sometimes the features are not collected, sometimes negative values are being collected, or sometimes due to certain technical difficulties the data points gets missing or stuff like that. So hell lot of stuff, and it's really messy. Like you cannot expect a very super cool data set to be given to you, like you see on Kaggle, like a super super cool data set that's clean, that's formatted, is given to you, and you just run your algorithms on top of that. But when it comes to real world, it's like you never know how the data would look like or how would the data come. So there is always a requirement to do a data pre-processing so that the data can be in a format, or so that you can utilize that data to bring certain values to your company, right? Like we saw how YouTube also uses data science and machine learning to generate their revenues by hooking you into their platform, right? So that they can showcase more advertisements to you. So like data processing, pre-processing the data into a understandable format. But why we need it? It's because real world data is a little bit messy. Not a little bit, but a hell lot messy, right? And you need to process it so that the machines can understand, so that the machine gets a data that's in an understandable format, right? So steps we followed, now we understood what is one of the major step in data science. Like we understood the data pre-processing, what is that and why do we actually need to do that. But okay, that being said, but what steps should I follow as a beginner, or what are the major steps in data pre-processing that one should follow? First of all, get the data and import the libraries. When we talk about libraries, it's like majorly NumPy, Pandas, right? Initially, NumPy, Pandas would be your go-to place for doing this data pre-processing and stuff like that. So first of all, get the data, import the libraries. Once you import the libraries, like we talked about NumPy, we talked about Pandas. So these libraries will help you in reading the data and generating the data. So let's say you have a data set in CSV format. So CSV is in Excel. Like whenever you use whenever you save your file in Excel, there is a format like save as Excel, save as CSV. That's comma separated value. So like every value that you have, it's separated as commas. So you want to read that data. Now the real world data came through CSVs. Now you want to read that data. So in the first go, we get that data. Let's say you got a file, and after you got that file, you put that file in your folder in your local computer. And then first of all, you imported the libraries. Once you have imported the libraries, you would utilize those libraries to read the data. What's there in that file, right? That's stored in your local computer. Once you've read the data, you will see that there are a hell lot of missing values. So we were talking about missing values. Let's say sometimes the data do not get printed, or the data doesn't get noted in certain server or in the database. So in that case, whenever you collect the data, whenever you do those things, you will see that there are certain, let's say, null values, or there are no values regarding that column or regarding that row. So in this case, you can see that there is a NaN, right? So NaN means there is not applicable, or there sometimes it becomes only blank, or there is nothing written. So first of all, you have to check whether there is some missing values or not. Once you see that there are certain missing values, you try to operate on them. That once now you know that you have got the data, you have imported the libraries, and using those libraries, you are trying to read the data. Once you read the data, you saw that you are trying to check whether there are missing values or not. Once you saw that there are multiple missing values or stuff like that, you would try to replace them, because no one wants to play with those missing values, and you cannot simply delete those. Let's say you saw that in a row there is a missing value, and you decided that I will delete that row. But that definitely leads to some catastrophic decision at a later point of time. Like sometimes that row that you deleted just because there was one pointer missing, the entire value or the entire decision got little skewed, because that was one of the major decision that has to be taken into consideration. So once you figured it out, what are the missing values, you try to replace them. How you replace them? Maybe through averaging. Like let's say through the average of that column, you saw that let's say the average is 100, but if my value is missing, let's say I impute it or I change the missing values, like I just filled that missing value with the average value, or there are certain other pointers too. So that my data looks complete, so that my data is into an understandable format, that machine also understands that, okay, I do not have missing values, because whenever you have that missing values, machine would say, like, I could not go ahead because I could not find the data, or I could not find the data in an understandable format. So got the data, imported the libraries, using those libraries, read that data, checked whether there are missing values or not. Once checked, you can replace those missing values with certain average and stuff like that. Then you can standardize. Let's say, why standardize? Standardize means that, let's say the data in your points varies from 0 to, let's say, 10 lakh. So it is really becoming tough for a data scientist to be in that huge number game, right? Because, so what they do, they standardize, let's say by dividing or by reshaping. Reshaping means all my values that I have from 0 to 1 crore or 0 to 2 crore that I have, those are being reshaped between minus 1 to 1. So let's say the highest value that I have in my data set, let's say that's 2 crore or like 1 crore 97 lakh kind of stuff. So that would be 0.97. So we try to represent those stuffs, and we have a mapping that we are trying to standardize, like every data that we have, it's between minus one and one only, or it's between zero and one only. We are trying to standardize, and it's really an industry standard to do those stuffs, and it's really cool stuff to do. Then once you have the data, once you have filled all the missing values, you have standardized your data, then it's time to split that data. Now, because the data is in understandable format, when we talk about splitting the data, it means like you kept 80% of the data for training purposes, like so that machine can train on top of that, and 20% of the entire data set or the entire real world data set that you have, you kept 20% of that for testing. How is my model performing? Let's say on training data set, you trained your model, you told your machine that, hey, learn from this. And once machine started learning, you gave him a test that, see, these are the 20 images, now tell me. And you try checking whether the model is performing well or not, or whether the machine is learning or not. That way you can check the accuracy and you can work more and more stuffs on that, right? So this was one of the major steps, like data pre-processing. Before splitting the data or before utilizing that data for analysis or for machine learning, it's important that you get the data in the correct format. So once you have done that, now it's time for exploratory data analysis. So exploratory data analysis is kind of like you do an exploration of the data. You investigate, like, in the data, like whether there are some anomalies or whether there is certain, like you have certain assumptions, or you want to check on which, like you want to investigate on data to see whether there is a pattern or not, so that you can see if there is a pattern, I can take certain decisions. If there is no pattern, I can do something else. So you want to just explore the data, because every time we as a human also want to purchase something, we also explore, right? How is this laptop? How is this mobile phone? Through the reviews and stuff like that. We investigate that process, right? Then only we take a final decision. Same thing, like if you want to use data science or machine learning for your decisions, you would also check, how is my data? How does my data look like? Is it the data is always collected on Sundays, or on Sundays the data is more collected, or stuff like that? You just want to explore. And because it really helps the team to take a better decision that, okay, on Sundays I need to put more stuff. Or let's say you are running a mall and you did an exploratory data analysis. You did an exploration on the data of how many people visit your mall. So you saw that on Saturdays and Sundays, the visit is comparatively more through the exploratory data analysis. And then you took a decision that on Saturdays and Sundays, I will deploy, let's say, 2 to 3 members more, or 2 to 3 more security guards to control the crowd, right? So this is how industry use exploratory data analysis, just to do exploration, just to do investigation. Why do we need it? It's like detection of mistakes. Sometimes you can also see that, is it like on Thursday my computers are not working, or is it like on Thursdays most of my staffs are not there, that's why the data is not getting recorded. So you can check for mistakes, check for assumptions. Like maybe you assume that on Thursday you have the most staff, but it turned out that most of the staff are absent on Thursdays. So you can check your assumptions, then you can check how, like, what's the relationship between various variables and stuff like that. So it, like, with EDA, you can definitely get sense out of that data. But again, like as we discussed for data pre-processing, what are the major steps? And then come similarly, what are the major steps to be followed for exploratory data analysis? First of all, like everything you do in machine learning or data science, it starts with a library, right? So when we talk about exploratory data analysis, you can have a hell lot of more libraries too. Like apart from NumPy, Pandas, you have Seaborn, you have Matplotlib. You can import those libraries just to do this exploratory data analysis. That's short form is EDA. Check the type of data. So with the help of data types, like you can check the data types, whether how is my data getting collected? Is the weekday? Because there are multiple ways of storing the data. Let's say someone stores Monday, Friday, Saturday like this, and someone stores Monday as first day of the week. So they give it one. Then Saturday is sixth day of the week. Sometimes they give that type of thing. So you can check that type of data, like what is the type of my data that's getting stored. You can check that just for exploration purposes. And then sometimes it happens that after you saw that after you saw the real world data set, you saw that there are multiple columns that might not be relevant for you as of now. Just like recommendation. So like when YouTube gives you recommendation, location would definitely play a role, but that's not the major role. The major role played by is your previous history, like what you watched. So if you watched dog's video, so definitely YouTube will give you a dog's video, even if most of the folks in Delhi doesn't love dogs, let's say. So let's assume that they do not love dogs. But YouTube would say that, okay, location is not that much relevant as of now. So let's focus or let's drop that column as of now. So you can do that and you can see how the models perform or how there are multiple columns which you can drop. Maybe you can rename the columns. Sometimes in database or in certain things you store, like someone stored the day of the week as W key, like something they stored in their own name or stuff like that. You can just rename that week, day of week, stuff like that. You can rename. And then removing the duplicates, there are multiple duplicate values that might happen. Let's say someone did a transaction and the transaction was duplicated, right? So you can remove those duplicates. And how you can do, because it's an investigation, right? EDA is an investigation. So you can remove the duplicates. You can do all those stuffs. And then detecting the outliers, like you can see the outliers. You can plot different features, like how is the feature progressing or how is the feature important for me. Then you have correlation metrics, that how is the relationship between various features out there. You can definitely focus on those things. So these definitely help you in investigating the data that you have, like what's the relationship between one variable and another variable. Now, as we were focusing on the data visualization in the last two slides, right? So this definitely comes in EDA. So, but an extension is like when we majorly focus on data visualization, we try to visualize our data. So like how my data looks like or what's the graphical representation. Like now I have a data, but I want to visualize how things look like through the help of charts, graphs, bar chart, something. Why it's important? Because every person in your organization, let's say you are interning at certain organization or you are working at certain organization, everyone working there doesn't understand those data science, doesn't understand those machine learning. If you showcase a chart or if you showcase a bar graph to them, they will definitely understand that better. So there are multiple data visualization techniques out there. Maybe you build a chart that says that 80% of our transaction or 80% of our revenue comes from India or 80% of our transaction values come from, let's say, Bikaner, or 80% of a transaction comes from Pune, right? So you have those, you can visualize those data using charts, then you can make plots, then you can have maps, right? According to maps, let's say you can map the area of Pune and you can visualize that how is the mobility of people in Pune, right? In COVID-19, how are the people of Pune behaving or how much they are traveling? So you can do those maps, and then you have trees, matrices. So definitely, like, these are a few data visualization techniques that you can focus on. But that being said, that you now understand a hell lot of stuff, like how to start machine learning, what is data science, what is machine learning, what are the core concepts of, like, what are the key components of a data science process. Now you understand. And now you would be at a better position to research a little bit more and start your projects, right? Now, every time you see that I have to make a project so that I can put those in my resume and go ahead, right? But make sure that you understand the concepts well before starting projects, because once you understand the concepts well, your pace of completing projects would definitely be high, and definitely you can complete those projects more easily. But you now know all those preparation stuffs, what things you need to learn, but you also would want to focus on what projects should I start with, right? So this is the last section of our session, so that we can end the session on time and can allow a few questions to come in. So what projects to start with? As a beginner, I focused on as a beginner, as an intermediate, so that everyone who is attending this session can tune themselves, can tune their preparations, can pick a project as per their current level, as per their current needs. So if you're a beginner, so just starting a journey in data science, just starting a journey in machine learning, so focus on Titanic dataset. So there is a few datasets that I'm talking about. That's Titanic. Another one is Iris. And then you have housing price sales prediction. So these three datasets, and on top of that, stock price prediction, store sales forecasting, though these are put in beginner's level, but as a complete beginner, I would always focus on Titanic, Iris, and housing price prediction. That would definitely give you an edge that how data science or machine learning is done. But on top of that, let's say you want a guide, like how actually these projects are done, because before starting your first project, you would need a kind of hand holding, right? So how things work or how should I go ahead with that, right? So I have also added a few links, right, so that you can see a YouTube video, like how actually people approach this Titanic survivor problem or the credit card fraud detection or Iris, like a lot of like how people actually approach these problems, machine learning problems. From a beginner perspective, these data sets can be definitely useful. But let's say you are fluent with those things, and you would try to focus on intermediate and advanced sections to build up your resume and stuff like that. So now you can focus on multiple intermediate or advanced libraries like OpenCV, TensorFlow, scikit-learn. And then you can focus majorly on certain specific domains, be it computer vision, be it natural language processing. So in natural language processing, you have Twitter sentiment analysis, then you have email spam classifier. At least start with them. It's not that you have to make a project that's like a SpaceX or that's like PayPal, right? So definitely start with something so that you get your idea, so that you get your hands dirty. Once you get your hands dirty, 2 to 3 basic projects or 2 to 3 intermediate projects you have made, you can figure it out and you can approach any solution, any problem on Kaggle or data or any hackathon that you want to participate. So this way you can move ahead and can do the projects and can add them in resume and can gain confidence and can add and can bag certain internships and stuff like that. So on LinkedIn, if you check my LinkedIn, I've definitely posted a few links to the projects, to the data sets which you can practice upon, right? And you can get the resources. I will definitely tell the organizers to post those resources in the chat so that you can also get the pointers out of them. And that was all from my side. And definitely now it seems a little bit daunting, like a lot of stuff covered in 1 hour, right? So like I try to cover it in 1 hour so that I can keep the last 8 to 10 minutes for Q&A. So now good luck. And definitely these things are a little bit daunting at the first go, but definitely as you start progressing, you can make things easier and you can, it's definitely a good thing to explore it, and you will definitely enjoy it as you go ahead and can improvise on top of that. So ask your questions now, and I will just tell the organizers to drop a few links so that you can also explore them and can refer to them at a later point of time. Yeah, so thank you so much, and thanks to the organizers for giving me an opportunity to share with you. And if you like the talk or if you have any feedback, you can get in touch with me over my email. That's ion.roy2000@gmail.com. Or you can get in touch with me over my LinkedIn and Telegram or stuff like that. So thank you so much, and let me answer your questions.
Thank you so much, Ayan. It was wonderful to have you. We have a question by Saurabh Singh in the chat. I'll be just showing it over here. How to look for jobs in learning as a fresher? Most of the 2 to 3 years of work experience in machine learning. Please guide.
Yeah. So like one of the biggest good pointer that you can explore is try to get an internship first. let's say you get an internship as a machine learning engineer, as a machine learning intern or a data science intern at certain organizations, try to do 2 to 3 months of work there, right? And once you graduate, you, as you know how the organization work and the organization has also trained you, so there is a high chance that they will extend a pre-placement offer to you. So that way you can definitely get a job at your as a machine learning engineer or certain other domains in your company of choice. So that's the best way. Get an internship as of now and try to convert it into PPO. In case you do not have that opportunity to convert your internship into a pre-placement offer, then definitely try to build up certain own projects. Try to participate in hackathons. There are certain hackathons where organizations come and take up interns, like the winners of that hackathons are taken as interns there. So maybe that's also a way, or sometimes they also hire, or there are hiring challenges also, like Machine Hack, like Analytics India magazine is organizing a machine hack competition that they not organizing, but they organized previously. So there multiple companies came up and they did a hiring challenge. So maybe you can keep a track on those things and you can completely get a job on the basis of that. And keeping in mind your communication skills and stuff like that are also good.
Right. Okay. So if there are, and have them too. I also had a question myself. So I was working data set, but there was a lot of data. I mean, there were a lot of features and there was, so like the data was a lot very skewed. So what can be done to reduce that
skew? Yeah. So like, first of all, got it. So first of all, a few things like whenever this is really a common challenge when it comes to the domain of data science or when it comes to a domain of machine learning. So first of all, we have to be very good with those feature engineering, right? Feature, how we engineer our features, how we reduce the features, or how we make our new features. And then on top of that, principal component analysis and stuff like that. These are definitely things that we should focus on. Like data pre-processing we discussed, like missing values and stuff like that, and data visualization. On top of that, there are certain other steps like feature engineering and hyperparameter tuning, right? Whenever you start with those machine learning algorithms or data science algorithms, you have this hyperparameters, right? The parameters, you can tune them and can make something awesome and can increase the results. So maybe even if you have huge data set, but it's like always the data set that you have, the more the data you have, that's better, right? But keeping in mind that data really contributes to your analysis, really contributes to building something, because otherwise it's only a single CSV file that's lying in your computer. So try to get the data that really helps to take the decisions and really helps to do the analysis on top of that.
Right. So we circulated a form in our college campus for asking for questions. So the questions, one of them was it was similar that I was asked, like people do not actually know how to do it as a fresher, and it seems a bit challenging. Like students shared that they started out with the Andrew NG machine learning course, but they weren't able to pursue it finally of theoretical knowledge, and there was less practical implementation. So few courses actually get directly started with the machine learning.
Yeah, definitely. So there is a two approach, because recently what happened was I was on a panel discussion. So we were discussing about two approaches of doing machine learning. So first of all, it's bottom up and the another is top down, right? So it's like the Andrew NG's course is bottom up. So you start from the very core basics, like the mathematical section, because it happens that in the week third or week fourth of Andrew NG's course, you see Andrew NG filling the screen with mathematical equations, right? So that makes a little bit daunting for the students to go ahead. And sometimes again, the assignments come that's in Octave. So it's like always that theory is more, right? But what we as a student miss is, we are learning something. We are learning the concepts. He told us something. Why not implement that in our own projects? Like, let's say we have a data set, right? Why not try to implement the things that he's focusing on? Let's say mean, mode, median, anything that he's telling. Why not implement the sections he's talking about into our own data sets? That's why I told that understand the concepts well before starting projects. And once you understand the concepts and try to implement those concepts in your projects, it really becomes easier for you as a student to fetch the details better and to make something good. And it will definitely help you to crack the interviews too, right? Because at interviews, it's like always the case. that like the person who has the great knowledge about those machine learning and things, the basics about those things, they definitely are preferred more, right? So try to brush up on your basics first.
All right. Okay. I think that's it for today. Thank you so much for joining us.
Yeah,
thank you. It was great to have you. And I'll be handing over to Hitesh.
Sure. Thank you, Devansh. And I think this session was pretty awesome. And I think all your doubts are clear, guys. So if you have some more doubts, then you can totally reach out to him on LinkedIn. And I will be sharing his ID. Also, just thank you so much, Ayon, for contributing with us and collaborating with us. So it was just a great session. So
thank you so much for the opportunity.
So I think we can conclude this meeting.
It was really great to have. Please like, comment, share, and subscribe, and press the bell icon for future updates. Thank you.
Thank you, guys.